Padre Dios, te damos gracias una vez más por estar aquí presente. En el nombre de Jesús, Señor, te pedimos que tú bendigas esta reunión, que tú toques los corazones de cada una de las personas aquí, Padre amado, para que recibamos de ti, Señor, algo especial, algo hermoso, algo que tú tengas para nosotros, Padre. Bendice, Señor, la alabanza, Padre amado. Bendice, Señor, la palabra que tú tienes para nosotros, la comunión entre los hermanos. Y bendice a cada una de las personas que quizás tengan un problema, una dificultad, una situación difícil. Bendícelo, Padre amado, y dale paz y tranquilidad. En el nombre del Padre, del Hijo y del Espíritu Santo. Amén.
Amen. I was going to have us do the first song in Spanish too, but Melanie couldn't come up with the words. So we'll do it in English. All hail the power of Jesus' name. This thing up a little bit, so you're gonna have to stand to sing it, I think. Jesus saves.
Morning, Chapel family.
Good morning, Mickey.
As I still croak out the announcements after all these weeks, but I'm feeling better anyway. We have praise reports. Jackie McClanahan, Wayne Mayfield, Johnny.
No praise.
Sorry, there's no praise reports. Then I have my glasses on. What's my excuse today?
I do have. Wow, she's got more things than I know.
I do have two additions that are not in the bulletin. Delma Hartnett is recovering after a hospital stay. And Daniel Chavez Sr. is in the hospital with pneumonia. He lost his wife 2 months ago, and he's elderly. So if you could spare him a prayer, we'd like to see him recover, please. Luke, our 12-year-old, the grandson of David and Marilyn Drake, his chemo did not work. He's 12 years old, and he's going to have to go through 9 months of treatments of something else to try to get rid of that leukemia. So please put him on your prayer list. The other prayer list folks are in the bulletin. It's Jackie McClanahan, Wayne Mayfield, Johnny Jones, Cheyenne Johnson, five men recently killed in the oil field, Bill Crines, Danny Goodwin, Janice, Sonny Rothmeyer, Marcella, Johanna McKinley, Jim Jackson, Emily Sains, Matthew Weinman, DJ and her dad, Kaylin Salazar, Paul Vescovo Jr., Sammy, and Jim Rader. Families needing prayers for their, they've recently departed are okay now, but the families need some prayer to get through their loss. Perry Mickles, Jack Van Berg, Punch Jones, and Lance Geisy. We have a birthday. We have Jerry Young this week.
Yay!
Actually, today.
Today. Happy birthday.
Yeah. For the children, we have Children's Sunday School at 10:30 during the services. We have Kids Club on Thursday night at 5:30. For the adults, we now have a Sunday School class. Actually, anybody could go to it. It's at 9:30 in the morning out here in the porch with Penny. The Ladies Fellowship on Tuesday afternoon at 4 is at Romina's house this week. Mm-hmm. Contact Romina and Fabian for directions if you wish to go. All ladies are welcome. It is bilingual. The Discipleship Bible Study is self-driven. See Daryl if you want the materials, and he'll get you launched. And unless anyone has anything else, that's it for announcements. Have a blessed week, and please, please, please do not get these germs.
I said, sorry, it's dangling from my hand. Our scripture this morning is Jeremiah chapter 23, verse 6. The title is Christ, the Righteousness of the Believer. The scripture says, this is his name, whereby he shall be called the Lord, our righteousness. And the prose written underneath that reads, Savior Divine, we know thy name, and in that name we trust. Thou art the Lord, our righteousness. Thou art thine Israel's boast. That spotless robe which thou hast wrought shall clothe us all around, nor by the piercing eye of God one blemish shall be found. Let us pray. Thank you that you are our God, O Lord. Thank you that you sent your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sins. Thank you for the miracle that he rose again. And that is what sets him apart from all other false gods and false beliefs. I ask that you be with those that we named and so many unnamed that are sick, that are in pain, that are depressed, that are distraught, that are fearful. For those who are grieving the loss of loved ones, or so many other things in our lives that we might grieve. for all of this, Father. You alone are our teacher, our comforter, and our guide. I ask that you spread your comfort, your love, your assurance, your strength, your courage, your healing upon these people. You are our only hope, and we grasp that. We cling to that. We believe that. We love you. In Christ's name I pray. Amen.
We need one other prayer for this week. Michael's going to play Beverly Hillbillies and travel to California this week to haul some furniture out to his daughter, and he'll need our prayers to hold everything together so he can be back here next Sunday for us. So he keeps me singing. A song for you called Child of the King.
Time.
Daryl, dear Heavenly Father, we do thank you again for all you do for us and for the chapel that we have, that where we can come and sing praises to your name and to worship you. And we ask, go with us into the service and bless Daryl as he brings us a message, and give him the words that you'd have us to hear. In Jesus' name we pray and ask these things. Amen.
You don't, I'm going to preach with my jacket on. Is that okay? Randy was saying we need to get up and run around the church a little bit. We have an automatic set on the heater, and it was not set for this weekend, so there was no heat when we got here. And I had to climb in a window because I forgot my key. So, and at my age, I never realized how hard it is to get in a window. I had one leg sticking way up like that, and it got a cramp. And I'm no cat burglar here. Well, as you know, we were on vacation, and we went out to see my mom. And my mom's 92, and got to visit with her. And my brother told me she hadn't been going to church. And so Sunday morning, I got her up, and she said, I don't know if I want to go, Daryl. And I said, Mom, all those times you made me get up and go to church, it's my turn. So I took her to church, and I'm trying to talk my brother into doing the same, but maybe he will. He was a little more open to it. As we get started today, if you remember the series I've been on, it's been on prayer. And I started out talking about Moses, how Moses, when he raised his hands during the battle, God fought for the Israelites. There was something in raising his hands at submission to God. And then the next week I preached on Daniel, and Daniel, how when he was confronted and they said, you know, if you pray to any other god besides the king, Darius, that you'll be thrown in the fire. And Daniel was so determined, so focused on God, that he prayed to the Lord anyway. He knew that God had brought him through so much that he wasn't going to turn his back on God because of what men say. And today we're going to talk about a king called Hezekiah. His name is Hezekiah, a mighty man of prayer as well. There was a little story about a church. They were on a mission trip, and it was in Mexico, and they were learning some Spanish, and this one guy on the trip, he thought he really had it down pat. So he went up to this little boy with a smile, and the kid was missing some teeth. You know, he hadn't got all his teeth in, and so he tried to say in Spanish, "How many teeth do you have?" And the boy just kind of looked at him. He didn't say it very well. But it's the same way with prayer sometimes. We think that our prayers aren't eloquent. We think that, you know, how can I pray to God? I don't know what to pray for. But we have to remember that God doesn't give us that look. He doesn't give us a look like, hey, I don't understand what you're saying. Because God is looking at the heart. He is looking at the intent of your heart. He's looking at us similar to the way we look at our grandkids or our kids. Do you remember when they would do drawings in kindergarten and they'd bring them home and you'd stick them on the refrigerator? Friends would come over and they'd look at this drawing, very abstract, and you'd say, yeah, my daughter, isn't she quite the artist? Or look at my grandkids, they're going to be such great artists someday. That's the way it is with God. However simple our prayer is, however might not make sense to us, God is listening, God understands, and he's as proud of you as you are of your kids, and even more because we're his child. But he wants us to pray more rightly and to pray more intelligently as we grow. And so that's why we're going through this prayer series. I told you early on that, you know, I'm not one to raise my hands very high. And I went home after studying that sermon, and I started making it a habit to raise my hands when I was praying. It helps me focus, because when I start thinking about something else, I'm praying. It's a reminder. That's one part of it. The other part of it, it's a surrender on my part. It's saying, God, this is my time with you, and I'm raising my hands in adoration of you. So take what you receive today, take what you receive from Hezekiah and put it into practice, just as I hope you have over the last few weeks. Learn to pray. Learn to pray. Hezekiah, he was a great king, a good king. His dad, not so much. His dad was a terrible king. But Hezekiah turned it around, and he became not only a political leader, but a spiritual leader of the people of Israel. I wanted to read 2 Kings 18:3-5-6. It says, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, just as his father David had done. Hezekiah trusted in the Lord, the God of Israel. There was no one like him among the kings of Judah, either before him or after him. He held fast to the Lord and did not cease to follow him. He kept the commands the Lord had given Moses. How would you like that to be said of you someday? Wouldn't that be a great testimony for someone to say that about you? Hezekiah didn't always have it good. He was good, but bad things happened, and one was the Assyrian king came to conquer him, brought an army of 185,000 men to come up against him. And as they were on that, getting ready for this battle, this king was a very smart king, this Assyrian king. And he decided instead of just addressing Hezekiah, he would address all the people of Israel. And so as he speaks, he says, hear the word of the great king, the king of Assyria, in 2 Kings 18:28-32. This is what the king says. Do not let Hezekiah deceive you. He cannot deliver you from my hand. Do not let Hezekiah persuade you to trust in the Lord. Make peace with me. Choose life and not death. Do not listen to Hezekiah, for he is misleading you when he says the Lord will deliver us. All the people heard that. All the people heard it. What happens when you hear some bad news like that? What happens when you get a letter? Because Hezekiah, he heard that just like the people did. And it can shake your faith. Things can come along that cause you to maybe not believe that God can deliver you. But Isaiah came along. Hezekiah said, find the prophet. Find the prophet Isaiah. And Isaiah sent word back to Hezekiah, do not worry. And here's the letter, because Shinanakarib, and I'm only going to say that a couple times. That's the king of Assyria. And as I, how did I do?
Terrible.
I do weddings sometimes, and sometimes the names get me. And it's, I kind of do it real quick. But anyway, this king, in 2 Kings 19, this is the letter that the Assyrian king sent to him. Hezekiah received the letter from the messengers and read it. Then he went up to the temple of the Lord and spread it out before the Lord. And Hezekiah prayed to the Lord, Lord, the God of Israel, enthroned between the cherubim, you alone are God over all the kingdoms of the earth. You have made heaven and earth. Give ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see. Listen to the words of Shechanarib has sent to insult the living God. It is true, O Lord, that the Assyrian king has laid waste to those nations and their lands. They have thrown their gods into the fire and destroyed them, for they were not gods, but only wood and stone, fashioned by human hands. Now, O Lord, our God, deliver us from his hand, so that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you alone, that you are God. That kind of letter forced Hezekiah to his knees. After he read what that king was saying, it forced him to his knees to pray. He went straight to the temple and spread out that letter before the Lord. And he prayed. He didn't come with plan B, C, or D. It was plan A all along. He knew where to turn, and he turned to God. And if there's anything in this first little part here that I want you to get, is that needs to be our plan from the very get-go, is to turn those things over to God. Not to try B, C, and D first and then come to God, but to come to him and say, Lord, I need your help in this situation. I don't know what to do, but I know that you have drawn close to me in the past, and you've helped me through so many things in my life, and I'm turning to you now. And there's principles that we're going to go through, and they're on the back of your bulletin, and the very first one is to fill up that faith tank first. And you can see how Hezekiah did that in that verse. He filled up that faith tank. He started to talk about who God was. He was reminding when he said, "Oh, God of Israel, enthroned between the cherubim." He is worshiping God. He's praising God for who he is, recognizing God for who he is. And when he did that, that builds up faith. We need to do that. What I was telling you, when I'm raising my hands, I'm thanking God for the beauty that's around me. I'm thanking God for my family. I'm thanking God for all that he's done. But I'm reminding myself of who he is and how great he is and how much he loves and how much grace he shows. Those are the things that build up my faith tank. And I don't know what you need for that. But it'll follow along the lines of Scripture. And many prayers in Scripture go first to pointing out who God is. They people of prayer, they're honoring God first. They're saying, "Lord, I know who you are, and I know you're a God that can come to my rescue." That's a prayer of faith. That's a prayer of faith. And when we begin to build up that tank, it keeps us from being a prayers of wishing to prayers of believing. People, we need to be prayer warriors that believe that God can come to the rescue. That's how we should be taught to pray. That's how we should pray. We need to come before him knowing that God can deliver. Hezekiah was reminding himself about who God is because he was shaken. Can you imagine 185,000 men ready to put you down in the ground? Fear, anxiety, you name it. But Hezekiah worshiped the Lord, and he built up that faith tank. He talked about the power that God has, his majesty and his sovereignty. Those things, who he is, what he has done. We need to thank God for all that he has done for us. Whether it's the wife or husband sitting next to you, thank the Lord for them. Or healing you. Maybe you've been healed of cancer yourself. Thank him for that. Or the taking away the anxiety that you might have. Let that confidence in God grow, and your prayer life will grow. Remember who God is and what he has done. Sandy, you can sit a little closer to Dave, you know. Be thankful for him. I saw you poking him. But that's good. Be thankful for those to whom God has given you, especially husband. Yeah, there you go. Looks better. There you go. There was a great man of prayer, and one of his statements was, "Almighty God, if I had 10,000 words, they would not be enough to begin to describe how great you are." So as you go into your prayer today, tonight, whenever you pray, start with those words. "God, you're so great. Look what you've made. Look what you've done for me. Look at how powerful you are." Go through Scripture and thank him for what you see, that God, through Jesus, heals, that God, through Jesus, saves. Those are the kind of things to remind yourself of as you're building up that faith tank. There was a sailor, and he headed out in a brand new sailboat, and he was going around the world. Great sailor. But the design of this boat, they had put a big keel and a bulb on the bottom of it, 800-pound weight to hold this thing steady in the wind. He went missing, and it was 3 months before that boat was found, and the hull was intact but upside down. Something had sheared off that keel, and without a keel, that boat was top-heavy and just couldn't sustain itself in those rough waters. And it's the same with God. What I'm getting at right here is prayer. It's the keel. That's the keel that keeps us upright. It's our prayer ballast, that faith, believing God is that ballast that keeps us upright. And when we believe that, when we truly believe that, our prayers will be prayed rightly, understanding who God is and what he can do for us. The next thing is to embrace the two S's of simplicity and sincerity. Hezekiah, he put it right out there. He said, deliver us from this king's hand so that all the kingdoms on earth will know that you are alone, our God. That God would protect him, save him from that bad king with a long name that I can't pronounce. Philippians 4:6 says, let your requests be known to God. Just put it out there. Whatever's on your heart, when you pray, after you've built up that faith tank, just make it simple. Say, Lord, you know my situation. You know my grandchild or my child, what their needs are. And I'm laying it out there to you as simple as I can, Lord. They need to know you. They need to trust in you. I need to trust in you more. Whatever it is, go to him and make it known. Don't ramble on. Just tell him. Matthew 6:7 says, and when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Bill Hybels says, just get to the point. What do you want to see me do is what you're asking God. You know, God just wants to hear that. You know, son, what do you want me to do? You know, no going on, no rambling, no showing off of how long you can pray or how many big words. Someone once said, never use a gallon of words to express a spoonful of thought. You know, just go before him. Be honest. Just tell him what you need. Anybody ever see that movie with Jim Carrey, Bruce Almighty? Can't believe I'm using this in a sermon, but we'll go with it. Freeman Morgan, he tells Jim Carrey, now I want you to pray sincerely. Bruce says, what do you want me to pray? You know, he's flustered about that. And Morgan says, I just want you to pray. Just go ahead. And so he says, Lord, feed the hungry, bring peace to all mankind. How's that? And Morgan says, great if you want to be Miss America. How many of you are like that sometimes? We don't know what to pray. And so we just throw out some phrases, you know, something that we think God would want to hear. What God wants to hear is what's down here. What God wants to hear is what's troubling you. What God wants to hear is what you're struggling with. That's what he wants to hear. He wants that sincerity in your prayer. And he wants it to be simple. Just get to the point. And the third thing is don't ask God to be where he already is. So many times, and I'm guilty of this, Lord, I pray that you will be with so-and-so. Well, as a believer, he's already with them. So why am I praying to God something that, you know, he's already with that person? Instead, Father, awaken so-and-so to your presence. You know, let them tangibly feel you around them, so that in their time of need, they can understand that you are with them. I don't need to ask God to be with them because he already is. I don't have to ask God to be in a specific place because he's everywhere. There's a site you can go on the internet, and if you want to put a prayer, this is a group. It's called newprayer.com. And they spent about $20,000 getting a satellite pointed at M13. It's a star cluster. And they feel that that's the last known place where God was. It has been. Okay, so they'll shoot that up there, that prayer for you. Do you see how silly that is? Because God is everywhere. We don't need to go somewhere to have a prayer shot into space. Because God fills this space. God fills this space, to get more specific. When you believe he is right here, he is with you always and promises never to leave you, so your prayers can be that personal. Your prayers can be to the living God who dwells within you. Psalms 139:7-10 says, God, Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise up on the wings of the dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. Isn't that a great scripture? My right hand will hold you fast. You know, we're in the middle of this building project, getting started, actually. And I was talking with Lynn Stokes, who's doing the first part, and Charlie's doing the second part, Greener. And the first part, just some things have happened already that, you know, I just said to him, I said, Lynn, we're seeing such great favor from God. And he says, Daryl, I'm believing we're going to see that favor all the way through this project. And I know we are. I know we will, because we're believing God. God, it's for his glory. It's so that he will be magnified. It's so that people will come to know him. So remember when we're praying that God is with us always. In 17 and 18, the Assyrian kings have laid waste to these nations and their lands. They have thrown their gods into the fire and destroyed them. For they were not gods, but only wood and stone, fashioned by men's hands. Hezekiah, filling that faith tank, keeping it simple. That's what we need to do. Most of all, keeping it consistent with his word. Knowing God's character, his power, and his knowledge that he knows. And I was using that so that phrase just a minute ago, and that's our fourth point, and it's an important point when we pray. So that. Hezekiah says, please, Lord, deliver us from the hand of Shechanashireb. Is that better? You got it? Sennacherib? Okay, we're settled on that. Sandy, every time I come to that, I'll just point. It says, so that all the kingdoms on the earth may know that you are alone are God. That so that is an important phrase that should be in our prayers. If you think about that, it's not so that Hezekiah would be spared. It's not that his wife and his kids would be spared. That's not his prayer. His prayer had those two words, so that you may be glorified, so that they will know that you are God and God alone. When we pray, our prayers should be that same way. You know, Lord, show us favor so that this chapel can carry your word to those that don't know you. We got to keep it so that God is glorified. That's a great prayer. The only one that lasts is the kingdom of God. And we need to pray that way so that the kingdom of God, so that God will be glorified. James 4:3 says, when you ask, do not receive, and you do not receive, because you ask with wrong motives, that you may spend what you get on your own pleasures. You see, when we're praying wrongly, it's going to have self in there. It's going to always be so that I may be, you know, not embarrassed. You know, Hezekiah could have prayed that way. Lord, intervene so that I won't look like a bad king. Have we ever had prayers like that? Lord, help me out so that people don't take advantage of me or whatever it is. Instead of, Lord, that you'll be glorified. That you'll be glorified by the way I live, so that people I work with will see you in me, that my children or my children's children will see in me something that will draw them closer to you so that they will follow you with all their hearts. That's a so that prayer. Have those prayers. Make that a, use those two words and just see what's following. It'll tell you a lot. Hezekiah, there is only one true God. That was the whole point of that prayer. Help me. And guess what happened? Guess what happened when that prayer was finished, and we're going to finish this up. God sent Isaiah to the temple, And Isaiah tapped Hezekiah on the shoulder and he said, God heard your prayer. And he said, he's got this. 2 Kings 19:31, the zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this. Now, you know, Hezekiah, being a man just like we are, flesh and blood, I'm sure he thought, okay, well, I better get the army together. God's going with us, but we're going to have to put up a fight here. That's not what God was saying, the zeal of the Lord. So God sent an angel, not 10,000, not 100,000. He sent one angel to the camp of the enemy, and he destroyed them all. The zeal of the Lord. Only one true God, and he's powerful. And he was Hezekiah's friend. Remember that. As you pray, remember that because Christ dwells within you, you're a friend of God. Through Christ, we're God's friend. When we pray, he listens. When we bring those petitions to him, when we pray rightly, he wants nothing more than to go before us. The zeal of the Lord will go before you, just as it did Hezekiah and the people of Israel. One true God. Because Hezekiah knew he served a powerful God. And he believed. It wasn't wishful thinking. He believed by faith that God would intervene. And he did. We need to pray. Learn to pray. With that kind of vulnerability. Knowing that we can't. It's not by our might. It's by his. And briefly, so that we don't go on and on, but just say, Lord, here's where I'm at, and this is where I need to be. This is where I am right now in my own Christian walk, and I need your help to get further along so that people will see you and me. That's sincerity. Get right to the point. No showing off. And put that so that in your prayers. So that God will be glorified. Get off your knees. Go back to work. God's got this. You know, as we pray today, I want you to have that confidence that God is working on your behalf. I want you to look maybe through the last few days or the last weeks or the last year and say, Lord, I saw you at work here and here and here. And I praise you for that. You're a great and mighty God. And I give you honor and glory for that, so that you will be honored by my life. Let's pray. Father, through this, I pray that we'll just learn to pray rightly. That like Hezekiah, he came straight to you with his needs. And I pray we'll do the same. That whatever need is in this room, Lord, that right now, our hearts are yearning to speak with you and to tell you of all the things that you already know, but you want to hear from our lips. Lord, we want you to move on our behalf. We want that favor because we're your child. I thank you for each person here, and I pray that you will just draw close to each of us because you are already here. Draw us closer to you. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Was that short enough?
What's he doing? Was that short enough? Is that what you said? I thought it was very interesting myself, very enlightening. Let's all stand. I'm going to put in a commercial for Michael. If you guys don't have any place to go for lunch today, Michael and his three-piece jazz band are going to be playing at Sacred Grounds from 12 till 3. You might go by and listen to him. He puts on a pretty good show down there. Let's sing God Bless America.